Imagine, it's a lovely morning in the village, and you are a horrible goose. More specifically, you're a bar-headed goose. And you're actually about to embark on a migration across the entire Himalayan mountain range. You'll regularly soar at altitudes over 7,000 meters, and by some accounts, even above the peak of Mount Everest. To be able to pull this off, a human would need to train for months to build up the lung capacity to handle the thin oxygen levels at altitude and build up their endurance to keep going for long hours, to say nothing of sprouting some wings. But you, a bar-headed goose, no extra training whatsoever. In general, it's hard to catch animals exercising. You're not gonna find a capybara pumping iron at the gym. But animals do routinely pull off feats of incredible strength and endurance, and they don't need to hit the treadmill to stay in shape, as far as we can tell. So do animals exercise? And if not, why don't they need to? Let's just clear out the most boring answer first. Almost every animal is on the move for at least some part of its life cycle, and running is not an exclusively human feature. One entire special issue of a journal looked at the concept of exercise in animals, but they used a very broad definition of exercise, basically just any physical activity that's more intense than normal. By this definition, many animals exercise on a near daily basis when they run away from predators or run towards prey, or when they engage in physical matches to win mates or territory. Other definitions of exercise include more intentionality. One review article on animals' physical activity cites the definition from the American College of Sports Medicine, which requires exercise to include structured movement intended to improve physical fitness. By this definition, a lot of the scientific literature will say that wild animals can't exercise. We can't assume that animals have intention to exercise beyond their instinct to survive, and if they do, it's under the influence of a meddling human. Like training your hamster to run an obstacle course, or the Iditarod with those very good dogs pulling their human on a sled for over 1,500 kilometers. In order to explore the question of whether wild animals exercise, it's worth considering the reasons humans exercise. We can't know whether animals have similar reasons, but we can compare the behaviors they perform and the results they get. The first reason that people might exercise is for fun. Kicking around a soccer ball with your buddies or taking a dance class can be a great hobby that involves physical activity, and your primary motivation for joining community soccer is probably not life or death. Animals also exhibit lots of play behavior, which is a surprisingly rich and complicated field of behavioral science. I can't ask my cat why she runs around in circles, backflipping off of her cat tower, but I'm sure she has her reasons. Young animals play to develop both physical and social skills, including hunting, and a well-beloved study from 2014 put a hamster wheel out in nature and found that thousands of curious critters came to take the wheel for a spin. So while play is complicated enough to get its own episode, we can tentatively say that physical activity equals fun in some cases. Humans also exercise to look good. In the movie Crazy Stupid Love, Ryan Gosling forces Steve Carell to go to the gym as part of his glow-up montage, and bodybuilders stack their muscles way beyond what is necessary for healthy physical function. In the animal world, showing off through physical activity often comes in the form of fighting for a mate. One of the more hardcore of these rituals is kangaroo boxing matches. I don't know when you last saw a male kangaroo, but they are jacked. Female kangaroos definitely notice, and they might be swayed by the visual appeal of a ripped suitor. Male kangaroos have been observed literally striking a pose to flex their muscles for a female. But these huge muscles may be a natural byproduct of hopping around with a massive body all day, every day, and using their muscles to fight, rather than specifically exercising to gain vanity muscles. So I'm a little more hesitant to call this one exercise. Other animals use methods of attraction that are a bit more demure, like the majestic birds of paradise. While some birds compete with bright colors and attractive feathers, the glorious bird of paradise uses that and more in its delightful mating dance. It could be argued that the bird of paradise dance is indeed a form of exercise, as they inherit the instinct of the dance steps through genetics, but they also train to hone their craft. While they pop out of the egg knowing how to dance, the males spend months rehearsing and training the steps with their buddies before performing for a female. Kind of like Ryan Gosling as Ken in the 2023 Barbie movie, when he tries to outdance the other Kens for Barbie's attention. Human workout aesthetics aren't limited to bulking up. As anyone who spends enough time on social media can attest, We humans may also motivate ourselves to exercise for the sake of losing weight. It might not surprise you to know that there's not a whole lot of evidence that wild animals exercise specifically to slim down. Geese don't have social media to make them feel self-conscious about their goose bodies. Domesticated animals can get overweight if they're fed too many treats by their humans, because they are so handsome and they all deserve it. But generally, wild animals simply can't find enough calories in their day to turn excess food into excess body weight. So some overweight pets might have to hit the kitty treadmill, but that's still more of a function of human activities than Whiskers wanting to look trim. Even though animals aren't lining the streets for a race as standardized as an Olympic marathon, they do have their own long-distance feats, like migration. As I talked about in the intro, barred-headed geese famously expend huge amounts of energy to migrate across the Himalayas. To prepare for this massive event, they apparently do absolutely nothing. A group of researchers banded together from all over the globe to study how these geese are able to endure such a long flight. They implanted little devices inside barred-headed geese to measure the birds' heart rate, acceleration, and other body stats to see if anything changed before their migration. And after a full year of recording, the geese were recaptured to collect and analyze the data. Overall, the geese's levels of physical activity didn't seem to change in prep for migration. In fact, two of the four geese studied showed a significantly decreased maximum heart rate in the days right before takeoff, so at least those two were chilling big time. Even though this study was only conducted on four individuals, these results could be supported by looking at the physiology of barred-headed geese in general. As it turns out, these geese are especially well-suited to handling low-oxygen environments. They have large lungs for their size, and they take deeper breaths and increase the amount of air they take in higher altitudes to offset the thinner oxygen. Plus, their hemoglobin is especially good at binding oxygen to transport through their body, even compared to that of closely related geese. So it looks like this is where humans are a little bit of an oddball. If you're a human and you try to go from couch to marathon in one day without training, that's gonna be a fast pass to the ER. But animals are acting in accordance with their biology. A fruit fly probably isn't gonna attempt international travel like Ryan Gosling in The Notebook setting off from South Carolina to Germany, but a monarch butterfly will migrate between Mexico and Canada. Those animals are literally built different. They can just do the thing. But before we get to the last reason, all science needs funding, so let's take a quick break.
This SciShow video is supported by Brilliant, an online learning platform that helps you build real knowledge through lessons you'll actually remember. Brilliant's courses are designed with strategies for fast skill building through interactive lessons on math, science, data analysis, programming, and more. And they're developed by professionals from places like MIT, Caltech, Microsoft, Google, you know, the experts. So you get to learn from the best, no matter what area you're interested in. And in the years that Brilliant has supported SciShow, we've seen them roll out so many new lessons on cutting-edge topics like AI. You can find them all to try for free at brilliant.org/scishow by scanning the QR code on screen or clicking on the link in the video description. And you'll get 20% off an annual premium subscription.
Finally, a big reason that humans exercise is just because it's good for you. Regular exercise can improve cardiovascular health, bone density, and your mood. Having a movement routine can help maintain your overall physical fitness as you age. But animals in the wild probably don't need to be doing all that because they don't have, say, an office job to make them sedentary enough to require exercising on purpose. Or they don't have a steady enough supply of calories to warrant spending effort on non-essential activity. Now, in general, there are very few studies of exercise and voluntary energy expenditure in non-human animals. However, one researcher who did a review on what literature does exist argued there could be a benefit to animals who spend a little extra effort in fitness training. The idea is, an animal that trains to be more physically fit before it becomes necessary to chase down some prey or outrun a predator will be better and more efficient at those bursts of activity. The challenge is that any energy an animal spends on physical activity is energy that isn't going towards reproduction. Besides literally staying alive, producing the next generation is top priority for animals in the wild. For now, it's hard to say if this trade-off is worth it or even takes place at all, because there aren't many studies on animals doing voluntary exercise for overall fitness. What studies do exist are all in the lab and take the animals out of their natural context. It's also possible that there is such a thing as too much exercise for animals. When you exercise, your cells produce unstable molecules called reactive oxygen species that can run around and cause damage to DNA and proteins. Kind of like Ryan Gosling in the 2011 movie Drive, driving all around town and leaving a wake of destruction in his path. Researchers research looking at different levels of animal activity suggests that moderate exercise could be beneficial, but too much could lead to a buildup of reactive oxygen species. So wild animals who are active near constantly may be increasing their risk of oxidative stress and lowering their odds of survival. But this review was looking at the effects in wild animals, and their conclusion was basically, we need to do more research. So if doing a decathlon brings you joy, I wouldn't hang up your javelin just yet. Overall, it seems that animals don't really need to exercise in the wild, but it really begs the question of why we do. If a barheaded goose doesn't need to train for a trans-Himalayan flight, it seems totally unfair that humans need to work out. It could be a byproduct of our cushy, sedentary lifestyles, or it might be that we have an appetite for levels of physical capability way outside the realm of necessary for survival. Like Ryan Gosling's character in the 2024 film, The Fall Guy, doing stunt jumps off a building or cannon rolling a car, humans weren't naturally made to do half the things we like to do, but we found a way to do them anyway. For example, there's an ongoing debate in the fields of biology and anthropology as to whether or not humans are built for long-distance running. Support for our natural running talent is shown in our muscle structure. While we may be, on average, mediocre sprinters, our muscle fibers tire out less easily than quicker species. This lower power is more oxygen efficient, so while other animals can definitely outspeed us, we'd win over long distances. This trade-off is applied to the endurance pursuit hypothesis, which theorizes that humans evolved specifically to hunt by winning a battle of attrition over faster prey. We just stalk them to death. Another point in favor of this hypothesis is that humans sweat much more than other animals during exercise, which helps us release heat very efficiently. Other animals don't sweat as efficiently, and without that onboard cooling system, they overheat and crash out sooner. Not everyone agrees with this endurance hypothesis. We might be good runners, but running is still far less efficient than walking. Secondly, tracking prey over long distances and strategically outlasting your target requires a fair amount of intellectual strategy. No shade to our ancestors, but some scientists theorize that the mental capabilities required for such a task simply hadn't evolved yet in the predecessors of Homo sapiens. You know, they were no Ryan Gosling in The Big Short, strategically min-maxing the system to hoard resources for himself. Plus, early hominids may not have really needed to be that crafty, given that they were probably already better at finding food than other animals in their habitat. And thirdly, not that many modern hunter-gatherer societies use endurance hunting. At least, not that researchers have been able to observe. If early humans had evolved this running strategy that was good enough to physically change the way our bodies evolved, surely this technique would be more common in modern hunting practices. Researchers supporting the endurance pursuit hypothesis have pushed back on this last point. A pair of scientists from the US and Canada searched historical accounts of hunting societies and found some evidence of endurance hunting all over the globe. Clearly, the book isn't going to be closed on this debate anytime soon. At any rate, our bodies have evolved such that we're able to even consider running a marathon. We have tools, mental and physical, that make it possible. Most other animals won't even come close. In general, it's hard to put intentionality to animals' actions in a way that clearly defines their movement as exercise. I'll indulge a little human centrism and say that we're probably the only species that truly exercises, according to our own definition, as well as maybe the domesticated animals that we cause to behave in certain ways. So while barheaded goslings might have grown up to beat us in terms of natural ability to summit Mount Everest, at least any human at the peak can be conscious of their strategy and skill and can enjoy the fruits of their intentional labor. You know, like Ryan Gosling dancing in La La Land. You guys really like Ryan Gosling, don't you?